This Torah class is brought to you by TorahAnytime.com.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Shalom Aleichem. Bruchim Abom. Tonight's learning should be Le'ilui Nishmas Mani Ben Rivka. It's Rani's maternal grandfather. V'gan Eden Tehei Menuchasai. I want to welcome Rani's mother, and family should only come for Surah Tovah, Simcha Sanachas. Also Le'ilui Nishmas Chananel Ben Esther, Gan Eden Tehei Menuchasai. And both the grandfathers should have an aliyah, V'gan Eden, Shibim Lisa Yisharm for Rani's mother, for all the children and grandchildren, Abiyas Goel Tzedek. So Parshas Vayeshev, which is usually the parsha we read right before the Yom Tov of Chanukah. There's a great principle that Rav Yosef Engel teaches us, that whatever is going to occur during the week is alluded to in the parsha of the week. So whatever is going to happen this week, it's in this week's parsha. So we look at Parshas Vayeshev and we wonder, where is there a remez to Chanukah in Parshas Vayeshev? Yosef, of course, has two dreams. He dreams about the bundles bowing down to him. And all the bundles are bowing down to Yosef's bundle that's standing up. And the brothers say, Hamaloch timloch aleinu, imashal timshal banu. And then Yosef has another dream. And in the dream, the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bow down to him. Nothing to do with Chanukah. However, the Bar Tanura, Rav Avadya Bar Tanura, uncovers that there's actually a third dream that Yosef had that's not mentioned in the Pasuk. You know this? There's a third dream of Yosef. How could there be three dreams? It only talks about two dreams. It says about Tanura, there's a missing dream. And here's the proof. They told Yosef, Vayachalom Yosef chalom, Vayaged le'elchav, Vayosif ol tzinoso. But it doesn't say what the dream is. Vayoymer alehem shemuna, and after the first dream, Vayosifu od sinooso al chalomosav, for his dreams. But only one dream is recorded so far. Clearly, there's a dream that Yosef had that's not recorded. What is it? In Parshas Vayechi, on the day that Yaakov Avinu was buried, and now this is very important because we're going to have to identify what day was Yaakov Avinu buried in Ma'arat HaMachpelah. We're going to see. On that day, the brothers got very nervous. Because they knew so long as Yaakov is alive, they have protection. They have insurance. Yosef's not going to do anything to them because Yaakov would get upset, but now Yaakov's not around anymore. So they're getting very nervous. So Yosef nips it in the bud. So the Pasuk says, Vayenachem otam, he consoled them, Vayedaber alibam, he spoke to their heart. What did Yosef say to console the brothers? The Torah doesn't say. The Gemara in Megillah, and Rashi alludes to it, says, Yosef told the brothers the following. 10 candles, couldn't put out one candle. How can one candle put out 10 candles? So Yosef telling the brother, you guys, you could have knocked me off. When you were in power, you couldn't destroy me. Now that I'm in power, I'm only one, I for sure cannot destroy you. Now, question. Why does Yosef compare them to candles? Why does he say, if 10 candles can't put out one, one can't put out 10? Why doesn't he say, if 10 camels can't knock out one camel, if 10 dogs, if 10 bears, why candles? If 10 Sifrei Torah, why does he compare them to candles? Says the Bar Tanura, he got it from his dream. What dream? The first dream. The first dream of Yosef, he saw 10 candles not being able to put out one candle. So he goes to the brothers, he said, hey, you guys, you can't knock me off. I had a dream. Yeah, really, what was in your dream? I saw 10 candles not being able to extinguish one candle. So the brothers hated Yosef when he told them that, because he was like instigating. He was saying, you guys can't knock me off. But it didn't really bother them that much because he wasn't having dreams of grandeur. He didn't imagine himself as king. He was just saying, you guys can't knock me off. So the Torah does not record that dream of Yosef. But the first dream of Yosef in this week's parasha is he dreamt 10 candles, couldn't put out one candle. So now let's make simple cheshbon. In the beginning of Parshas Vayeshev, Yosef has a dream. How many candles in the dream of Yosef?
Well,
11. 11. 10 candles, can't put out one. 11. He then goes and he tells the dreams to the brothers. So how many more candles do we have? Another?
11.
Yeah, this guy's on the ball. Right. He dreams, 10 candles, can't put out one. He repeats the dream, 10 candles, so we're up to how many? 22. And then in Vayechi, he consoles them. What does he say? If 10 can't put out one, how many more is that?
That's still 11.
Another 11. Then how could one put out 10? Another? 44 candles of Chanukah. This is a remez to the 44 candles of Chanukah. You heard it here first. Doesn't say it in any... So Yosef has a dream, 11 candles. He says over the dream, another 11 candles. He consoles them, 10 can't put out one. He then says, then one can't put out 10. That's the remez to Chanukah in this week's parsha. Probably the most well-known two words in all of Talmud Bavli are the two words in Masechet Shabbat, Dav Chaf Aleph Amud Beis, Mai Chanukah. Yeah, could you come up with two words that are more well known in the whole Talmud Bavli than Mai Chanukah? What is Chanukah? And the Gemara goes on to tell us what exactly is the miracle that we commemorate on Chanukah. And the Gemara tells us the Greeks entered the Heichal and they contaminated all the oil in the Heichal. Then the Chashmonaim prevailed and they come into the Heichal and they're searching and they find one flask of oil. And it's enough to last for one night. It lasts for 8 nights. Says the Gemara, L'shana ha'acheret, in year 2. Did you know that? In year 1, what did they do on Chanukah? Nothing. Nothing. They didn't celebrate Chanukah in year 1. In year 2, Kavum va'asa'um yamim tovim b'hala v'hoida. Now we learned something very important from this Gemara. That even when you have the greatest idea in the world, Chanukah! You always need to be patient. You always have to deliberate. You always have to think it over. You have a good idea? Don't be pachas. Even Chanukah, they said, let's wait for year 2. Year 1, we don't establish anything. So somebody comes running over, I have a great idea for the Beit HaKnesset. Good. Let's think about it. Let's talk about it. We don't run to do new things. By the way, it's interesting. You know, there's a famous question of whether to say Hallel on certain days in the calendar that miraculous events happened, especially in the modern day a Jewish world with the state of Israel. And it was posed to the Tzitz Eliezer about saying Hallel on certain occasions. And he said, why do you think in the times of Chanukah they didn't establish Chanukah in year 1? He says, because it was a great miracle. But you know how many Jews died in the war? They were slain, there were casualties. There were people suffering. There were families grieving. You always have to be sensitive when you want to establish a Yom Tov or say Hallel. Yeah, but what about those who are not so fortunate? So they delayed it. They delayed it till year 2 because of the casualties of year 1. Okay. But bottom line is, if you look in the Gemara, what is the miracle that we celebrate on Chanukah? The miracle of the oil. That's it. That's what the Gemara says. And yet, to say that Chanukah is a celebration of the miracle of the oil is very surprising because historically we know that the Jewish people were fighting for survival. The Torah was in jeopardy. The Yevanim wanted to abolish Torah and mitzvot. If you look in Al-Hanisim, we don't say a word about the miracle of the oil. It's about the military victory. Rabim biyad ma'atim, tmeim biyad tahorim. Not a word about the oil. Nothing about the shemen, nothing about the burning of the menorah. Asks Reb Chaim Shmulevitz. You know Reb Chaim Shmulevitz was one of the Rosh Yeshiva in the Meir Yeshiva in Yerushalayim. Say in the 70s, Of course, he was learning in the mirror in Shanghai already. And Reb Chaim Shulevitz says, you know, from Al-Anisim we see clearly the main miracle is the military victory, and from the Gemara it seems like the main miracle is the miracle of the oil. It's somewhat of a contradiction. The Gemara talks about only the oil, and the Al-Anisim talks about only the military victory. Let's ask another question. Question of Pnei Yehoshua. Pnei Yehoshua was a great rabbi in Frankfurt. But Maran, Gaon Uzenu, Maran Chida, Reb Chaim Yosef David Azulai, in his travels throughout Europe, was in Frankfurt. He met Pnei Yehoshua. He records when he saw Pnei Yehoshua, Upanov Kifnei Malach Hashem Tzvakot. That's what the Pnei Yehoshua looked like. Who else asked this following question? Chacham Tzvi, Chacham Tzvi, Reb Tzvi Ashkenazi, father of Reb Yaakov Emden. I had the zchus to be at the kever of Chacham Tzvi. He's buried in Lvov, Lemberg. You know where that is? In the Ukraine. Don't go there right now. Stay here, right? But he's buried in Ukraine. Actually, on the last day of my trip in the Ukraine, we were trying to get to the airport, and we didn't know exactly where the kever was. He's buried in the backyard of a hospital in the middle of nowhere. You know who's buried on that location? The Taz, the Sma, the Shoa Lomeshiv, Yeshua Yaakov, Chacham Tzvi. Really amazing. Anyway, so he asked the following question. There's a halachic principle called Tuma Hutra Bitzibur. You guys know about this principle? You do.
It's probably a subconscious thing.
Yeah, I would say so, right? So, Tuma Hutra Betzibur. You know what Tuma Hutra Betzibur means? If the majority of the community is Tamei, you're allowed to do the Avodah Betuma. That if the majority, if most of the Jewish people are Tamei, and all you have is Tamei oil, you're allowed to use Tamei oil. That's the rule. Tuma Hutra Betzibur. If the majority of the Jewish people are Tamei, you could do the Avodah Betuma. In that case, why did God make the miracle of the oil that we found one flask of oil and it was enough to light for one night and it lasted for 8 nights? What did we need this miracle for? We didn't need Tahar oil. We could have taken the Tamei oil and used the Tamei oil. After all, the majority of the Jewish people were Tamei. They were Tamei mace. They were involved in warfare. They were all Tamei. So use Tamei oil. You don't need to use Tahar oil. You'll say, well, it's better to use Tahar oil. No, it's not. Pnei Yeshua says, it's not even Hidur to use Tahar oil. We know that God doesn't make miracles for nothing. He doesn't just, you know, make miracles for the fun of it. Why did the Almighty make the miracle that the oil lasted for 8 days? We could have just used Tamei oil. Let's talk about Yosef HaTzadik. You heard of him?
Yeah.
You know where he's buried? He's buried in Shechem. By the way, you know the Zohar HaKadosh says in Tikkuni Zohar, why is Chanukah called Chanukah? Chanu, they were victorious, Chafei, with the 25 letters of Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad. Count the letters, 25 letters. How many letters in Baruch Shem Kavod Malchuso La'olam Va'ed? 24 letters. Says the Zohar, when you finish 24, Baruch Shem, and you get to 25, Shema, Chanukah. Another remez in Vayeshev to Chanukah, because where did Yosef go to find the brothers? Shechema. Shechema is Baruch Shem Kavod Malchuto. So that's another remez to Chanukah in the beginning of Vayeshev. Anyway, so when Yosef was sold, he was sold to who? Our cousins, Yishma'elim. Archat Yishma'elim. And what were the camels carrying? Gamaleim nosim nechot v'tzari velot holchim lahorid mitzrayma. They were carrying good smelling spices and perfumes. And Chazal comment in the Yalkut Shemoini, Sheha krovim shalanu, our cousins, they're not necessarily known for reach hatov shalahem. That's not what they're specialized in. Reach tov. I remember when I was a kid, the first time I went to Israel. Nowadays, you go to Israel, there are two parts of Hebron. You go to the Jewish section, you go to the Ma'ara. Actually, when I was just there, they opened up the Arab section for us, just one block. They open up one little gate of the Ma'ara. You walk out a half a block. Kever Avner Bener. First time in my life, it was Kever Avner Bener. Anyway, but when I was a kid, it was Me'uravim Zebezeh, Yisraelim. And I have cousins, and they like to go to these places. So they took the unknowing Americans into the heart of Hebron. And I remember one Arab darted at us with a baseball bat, and our guide had to pull the pistol at him. Anyway, we were walking through the streets. I remember as a kid, I think I was like 10 or 11 years old, fearing for my life. There was a foul odor, a really terrible odor. And people said, yeah, don't worry, you'll see. It's the swimming pool. It's the swimming pool. So we came up and we saw a bunch of our krovim, you know, our cousins. They were in the swimming pool. The only thing is the water was not clear and it wasn't a pool. It was a sewer. They were swimming in the summer in the sewer. That's kachidarka. So Rashi asked, the Yishma'elim are not known l'reach hatov shalahem. So in that case, why does the Torah say that they were carrying the samim? Usually they carry hides, itran, bad-smelling things. Says the Medrash, look what Hashem prepares for Yosef HaTzadik, that Yosef is being transported in comfort. He's being transported with a good smell. What are Chazal telling us? You think Yosef cared that it smelled good? He's being kidnapped. He's being hijacked by terrorists. They're taking him from the house of Yaakov, where Yosef stood at the pinnacle of the world. His father was teaching him everything from the Yeshiva Shem Be'Ever. He had Kesonet Pasim. He had everything he could have wanted. And Yosef's being kidnapped by terrorists. But don't worry, Yosef. The terrorists are wearing very nice cologne, Calvin Klein cologne. I'm sure there's better. I don't know. But the terrorists, they smell good. You think Yosef cared that it smelled good in the caravan that was transporting him from Eretz Yisrael to Ervat HaAretz, to the most degenerate, decrepit society in the whole world? Why is the Torah telling us this? Of what was the purpose of Hashem making the terrorists smell good? When the Jewish people left the land of Egypt, God says, guys, I want to give you a little weather report. Hayom atem yotzim b'chodesh ha'aviv. It's springtime, guys. Enjoy the weather. It's a sunny day. It's nice outside. It's 78. It's like San Diego today. I don't understand. You think the Jewish people cared what the weather was like when they got out of a Holocaust of 210 years? They were being abused and tortured for 210 years. The Egyptians took their babies and put them in the pyramid in the cement. 2.4 million Jews were murdered in Egypt. And Hashem says, guys, what a nice day it is. The weather is really beautiful outside. They would say, God, just get us out of the Gehenna. Forget the weather report. We'll worry about the weather report when we have more important things to worry about. You know, my grandfather, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, was liberated from Dachau, 1945. He was in all the dark places. He was in Auschwitz. He was in the gas chamber. He was pulled down the last second. You think when American General Henning Linden liberated my grandfather, he said, Rabbi, you know, the survivors, they were skeletons. You know, you could see their bones. They hadn't eaten for 6 years. They were emaciated. Rabbi, what a nice, isn't it a beautiful day today? Would that even be nice to point out? Was that even relevant? Why is Hashem saying, guys, weather report on the 8th, Hayom atem yotzim b'chodesh ha'aviv? Furthermore, let's just study for a moment. Does anybody know how long did this good weather last for? Where were the Jewish people stationed when Hashem gathered everyone to leave Egypt? So Rashi tells us that the moment Hashem said, let's get out of here, all the Jews were miraculously transported to Ramses. And that's where they started to bake their dough. And then when they got to Sukkot, what happened at Sukkot? They got Anani HaKavod. Now when the Anani HaKavod came, they were in like this climate-controlled, temperature-controlled bubble. They had no idea what the weather was. It could have been 150 degrees, they had AC. Could have been 20 degrees, they had heat. They couldn't even detect the weather in the Anani HaKavim. So the only time they could have felt the weather is in between Ramses and Sukkot. Does anybody know how much time there was between Ramses and Sukkot? Not more than 17 minutes and 30 seconds. Because they baked their dough in Ramses and it didn't have a chance to rise. It did not become chametz. So how long exactly did the Jewish people have good weather? For less than 18 minutes. Even though, by the way, Ramses to Sukkot, Rashi says, is 120 mil, but they got there in split second timing. So God is making this big deal about the good weather and how nice it is and the sunshine. It was only 17 minutes. Who cares? They're free. They should say, God, we're free. We're liberated. Who cares about the weather? Says Reb Chaim Shmulevitz, let's talk about Yosef HaTzadik. As Yosef HaTzadik is being taken down to Egypt, he's in a grave danger. His world is coming crashing down. He's been kidnapped from Yaakov Avinu. He's been taken away from the land of Israel. You know what Yosef might think? God is abandoning me. God is rejecting me. God hates me. He's ignoring me. I'm helpless. I'm hopeless. Says Reb Chaim Shmulevitz, the good smell in Yosef's caravan, it's not the good smell, it's the message of the good smell. The good smell is, I'm not abandoning you, I'm not forsaking you, I'm not leaving you, I'm not ignoring you, I'm taking you somewhere. You don't know why. Yeah, of course it doesn't seem good, but recognize, it's me, it's God, I'm bringing you down on a mission. You know what the message was? Anoichi ered imcha Mitzrayim, I'm coming down with you. And that was like a ray of light in Yosef's dark world. And it gave him the perspective that he's on a mission. It was not an isolated miracle. It wasn't a random miracle. It put into context what is happening to Yosef. He's not being abandoned. He's being guided. Now, we know that on Hanukkah, whether you like it or not, you're going to be giving some gifts. Whether you like it or not. Now, you know where it came from. It came from Magen Avraham says, you're supposed to be Mefarnes, Tamidei Chachamim. And then what it came to, then you give gifts to your kids, kindergarten teacher, and then somehow the kid gets the gift. The kids always get the gift. But you can be giving, and you got to give gifts to your wife, you know. Here's the thing about a gift. The greatest gift God ever gave the Jewish people, He took us out of Egypt. It's a jail. No one ever escaped. It was unescapable. But when you give a beautiful gift, as a sign of love, you can't just give a gift. Imagine if you came home and your wife said, oh, what do you have for me? Oh, here, the ring, here. And you put it on her hand. Nah, I mean, come on, that's classless, come on, you know. You can't just drop the piece of jewelry down. Oh, what do I have for me? Oh, yeah, here's the necklace, here, take it. What do you got to do? You put it in, I'm going to teach you boys. You put it in a nice box. Put it in a nice box. The nicer the box, the more you could get away with less retail value of the gift, right? You put it in a nice box. You put nice wrapping paper around it. A ribbon's going to save you $100 on the retail value of the gift. $250 you save on a nice card. He's leaving. He's out of here. He doesn't understand these things. You want a nice card. Does the ribbon increase the retail value of the gift? No. Does the wrapping paper make the gift more valuable? No. But it shows you're not just giving the gift because you have to. Yeah, it's that time of year. So here's the diamond ring. Here's the necklace. It shows you're giving the gift with a touch of love. It's an intangible touch. Says Reb Chaim Shmulevitz, God took us out of Egypt. That was the greatest gift in history that anyone ever experienced. He took out an entire nation of 3 million Jews from a land that nobody was ever able to escape from. But the Ribbono Shel Olam says, I'm not taking you out of Egypt because I have to take you out. I'm taking you out because I love you, and here's the proof. You see the weather? See what a beautiful day that it is? The beautiful weather is the wrapping paper. It's the ribbon. It's the bow. It's the box. It's the touch of love. I'm doing it not because I have to, because I love you. So Reb Chaim Shulevitz says, the mashal is, it's like a family. They have a precious heirloom. And it's in their family for many, many generations. And then they move, and the heirloom is gone. They can't find it. And they're looking, they're searching, the attic, the basement. Nobody could find it. And the 10-year-old boy, he looks under the couch, he finds the heirloom, he comes running to dad, he gives it to dad. So everyone's overjoyed, everyone's jumping for joy. And the father goes over to the kid and he gives the kid a kiss on the head. So the whole family's happy. But who's the happiest? The boy. Because the boy is happy, not only was the gift found, the boy's happy because he got a kiss from his father. The weather is not important. The weather is irrelevant. But it is important because it's the message. The weather is the wrapping paper. It's the bow. It's a kiss from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I took you out not because I have to. I took you out because I love you. The military victory was the miracle we needed. Our life was in danger. The Torah was in danger. Without Hanukkah, without the military victory, we wouldn't have Shabbos. We wouldn't have Chodesh. We wouldn't have Milo. We wouldn't have Judaism. You would have no Kugel. But says Reb Chaim Shulevitz, the fact that God gave us military victory, He had to. Then who's going to be His people? The North Koreans? Who's God going to have? Who's God going to have in this world? Who's going to serve Him? So God had to save us. But Hashem says, don't make a mistake and think I gave you the miracle of Hanukkah because I had to. I did it because I love you. Let me take the miracle of Hanukkah. I'm going to put it in very nice wrapping paper. I'm going to put a bow around it. That's the miracle of the oil. You don't need the miracle of the oil. You could light with tamei oil. It's just as good. But I'm making a miracle to show that I did this for you out of love. It's ha'arat panim. It's a sign of ahava. It's neshika me'akadosh baruch. And that's the greatest cause of celebration. I want to share with you the most well-known question, not only on Hanukkah, but period in Judaism. You all know the question. Who's going to say the question? The question of the Bet Yosef. Actually, it's not even the Beis Yosef's question. It's already brought in the Eshkol. Reb Mitch, what's the question?
Why 8 days?
What do we have 8 days for? They had oil for one day. So miraculous lasts another 7 days. So just have 7 days of Hanukkah. There are many, many answers. One of the well-known answers is given by the Altar of Kelm. You think it's only a miracle when oil that's supposed to burn for one day burns for 8 days? It's a miracle that oil burns, period. We're just used to it. It's teva, it's nature. But we take it for granted. We expect oil to burn. But if you think about it, do we understand why oil burns? Right? You know the famous Gemara Masechet Ta'anit about Rabbi Chanina ben Dosa. One day he saw his daughter. By the way, I just hit me. I think the Gemara of Rabbi Chanina ben Dosa is Daf Chafei in Maseches Ta'anit. So, I think so.
Go check it out
later. So, he saw his daughter was sad. He said, "Why are you so sad? Farvas veinstu? Yeah, you speak Italian? Farvas, why are you crying?" So she said, "I accidentally lit vinegar instead of oil." He said, "Mi shamar shemen." He who says oil should burn should say vinegar should burn. In other words, we expect oil to burn because we've labeled it teva, and we expect teva to do what it needs to do. But when it comes down to it, it's just as miraculous that oil burns, then vinegar burns. So we have one day to celebrate the miracle that oil burns. You ever hear that answer? Of course, I'm sure everyone heard it. Isn't that the worst answer to the Bet Yosef's question? Really? Are you kidding me? That's like somebody thought of that? That there's an extra day of Hanukkah to celebrate that oil burns? That's like a cheap answer. You know why? You could tack on an extra day to every Yom Tov. Oh, Sukkot, we should have an extra day. One for the miracle of the Anani HaKavod. And you see a guy, he's sitting in the Sukkah on Simchat Torah. What are you doing? Oh, that's the day that's to celebrate the miracle of clouds in general. Clouds, don't you know the answer to Bet Yosef's Kasha? That not only is Anani HaKavod a miracle, clouds are a miracle. I mean, that's like a tack-on answer. You could do that. What? 7 days of Pesach for the mirror, for the fact that God took us out of Egypt. And one, that we have a house. You know, that we live in a house. I mean, you could do that to any Yom Tov. You could tack on an extra day. Any day that we celebrate as a miracle, we should have 2 days Purim. One day to celebrate that God saved us from Haman. And one day to celebrate the fact that we're alive, you know, in general. It's a miracle. That's a cheap answer. You go for that answer? No, I'm not sold on that answer. And by the way, Rav Moshe Feinstein also gives this answer. And Rav Moshe says, that's why in Ala Nisim, we say nothing about the miracle of the oil, we just say, V'hidliku Neirot. To recognize that the celebration is not only the miracle of oil lasting extra, but that oil burns, V'hidliku Neirot. But what does this answer have to do with Hanukkah? Actually, it's very interesting. Rav David Cohen, David Cohen is Rashiva of Chevron Yeshiva, and he writes that that's why we say B'nei Bina Yemei Shmona Kavushir Urananim. What does Bina mean? Bina means Lehavin Davar Mitoch Davar, inference. The B'nei Bina, they saw 7 days of miracle. And then they said, why should we only celebrate 7 days of miracle? Really, the fact that oil burns in general is a miracle. So they used Bina to be Koveya Shmona, to make an eighth day. But still, what does this have to do with Hanukkah? By the way, we know, you know the famous words of the Ramban in Parshas Bo. The Ramban says, I want to read to you his words. Min hanisim hagedolim hamifursamim. From the great and obvious miracles. Adam modeh benisim hanistarim. A person acknowledges the hidden miracles. The fact that a person could take in oxygen. Think about it. Without oxygen, you couldn't live. What? Your body, every cell in the blood needs oxygen. And somehow, you're able to breathe in a gas and the gas diffuses to every cell in your body. How's that even possible? It's a miracle. So the purpose of open miracles is to acknowledge the hidden miracles. Says Ramban, Shehem Yesod HaTorah Kula. They are the foundation of the whole Torah. She'ein le'adam chelek b'torat Moshe. Ad shenaamin b'chol divareinu u'mikreinu shekulam nisim ein bahem teva. You know, we think that it rains automatically. We think, yeah, when there's enough moisture in the atmosphere, so it condenses, and then the wind blows the clouds from the ocean to the dry land, and then it rains, and it happens again, and then it happens again. But it's not true. Because Ani ma'amin be'emunah shleima, that when we daven properly and we learn Torah, we do mitzvot, then there's more rain and there are more crops. And even though we think, oh, the economy, there are cycles, sometimes it goes up, sometimes it goes down. The reason why the economy is bad is because of the Democrats, and as soon as the Republicans come in, the economy will improve. Everyone has different reasons why the phenomena of this universe could be predicted. But it's not true. That's kfira. We believe the economy is lousy because of our Torah mitzvot that need improvement. And you say, what do Torah mitzvot have to do with the economy? The way I put on tefillin affects the economy? Yeah, we have emunah that our ma'asim affect nature, affect our health. Why does the way I daven affect my health? If I exercise, I'll be more healthy. Not if I daven, I'll be more healthy. No, because we believe everything in this world is nisim ein bahem teva. So the purpose of the 7 days is to recognize the 8th day, the fact that oil burns is a miracle. But what does it have to do with Chanukah? Okay, so now we're going to get a little mystical. Ready? We know one of the great Kabbalistic teachings, one of the basic teachings, is that God created the world with 10 statements. Ba'asara ma'amarot nevra ha'olam. The Maharsha says that these 10 statements are the Esar Sefirot, the 10 mystical manifestations and emanations of God. Now this is a classic example of a mystical teaching that is misinterpreted, because we cannot, sometimes you see diagrams, a head, and arms, and feet. Chas v'shalom. Ani ma'amin be'emunah shalema, shehabor yisbo shemo, eino guf, velo yasigeyu masigei haguf. He has no physical component. This is just a way with which God allows us to relate with how He interacts with creation. What are the 10 sefirot? Das, Keter, Chachma, Bina, Chesed or Gedula, Gevura, Tiferet, Netzach, Hod. Number 8 is Hod. By the Hod, Yesod Malchut. By the way, Rashi Tevot of the 10 Sefirot, Gematria, 541. Yisrael, 541. Okay? The 8th sphira is Hod. Says Tikkunei Zohar, every sphira corresponds to a different Yom Tov. Netzach, Purim. Chua Samha Yisala, Netzach. Chanukah, Hod. Says Maran Chida in Sefer Dvarim Achadim. If Chanukah is Hod, Hod is the 8th sphira, we have 8 days of Chanukah. That's another reason why there are 8 days of Chanukah. But Yosef asked there should be 7 days. 8 days! Hod is Sfirah number 8. In fact, the idea is that through Chanukah, the mystical emanation of Hod comes to fruition. Say, what, Rabbi, what are you talking about? That's, you know, you pulled that off good, but I don't know what you're talking about. What is Hod? In Lashon Kodesh, we have 2 words. Hod and Hadar. Hod v'hadar l'fanav oz v'chabim kama. Yeah? What's Hod and what's Hadar? This is very important. Anybody know what's the difference between Peri Eitz, Hadar? Beauty. What's Hod and what's Hadar? Hadar is external beauty. Esrog, nice color, nice shape, nice bumps. Aesthetic, external beauty. But sometimes you'll see somebody, they're not objectively good looking. They might be objectively ugly. But they have a lot, but you like them. They have a lot of charm. There's something about them. They have not external beauty, they have inner beauty. Where does the inner beauty come from? It's ziv pinimi. Maybe chachma, their wisdom, their anivut, their humility, their good character. The difference between Hod and Hadar, Hod is inner beauty. Hadar is external beauty. You know what the dispute between Yavan and Yisrael is? Yavan is Hadar, outer beauty. You go to the gym, you have good muscle tone, you have good muscle sculpting, body sculpting, you look good. If you look good, you're a good person. If you look flabby, you're evil. You don't look good, it's not aesthetically nice, it's rotten, it's bad. It looks nice, it's pleasing to the eye, it's good. Yavan believes in hadar, external beauty, superficiality, But what does Yisrael believe in? You could have Talmid Chacham, he's 100 years old. Maybe objectively, he's not the most handsome tzaddik, but he is Malay Chain. He's Malay Ziv Penimi. He's Malay Kedusha. You're drawn to it, not because of an objective, external aesthetic beauty. It's Ziv Penimi. It's Hoid. Hoid. Hoid is inner beauty. Hadar is outer beauty. That's level one. Ready? We're just going to dig a little bit further. You know what else Yavan believes? Yavan believes the way the world works is what you see is what you get. If you could measure it, if you could weigh it, if you could calculate it, then it exists. Hadar! The outer way the world works. There's this much moisture in the air, so it's going to rain this amount of inches. Tomorrow at 3 p.m. it's 40% rain. 5 p.m. 50% rain. Why? We could measure it. We could calculate it. But they're Nevi'e Sheker, the weather reporters. Why? Because it's Kulo Nisim. Because just because we don't only believe in something you could measure and weigh. We believe in Olam Haba, even though we can't measure and weigh it. We believe that following Torah and Mitzvot improves the economy, improves your health, improves your lot in life. You can't measure it, you can't calculate it, you can't weigh it. Because we don't believe only in Hadar, outer external facade. We believe there's an inner working. There's an inner mechanism in the universe. And that is Hashgacha Pratit is not Hadar, it's Hoid. The machloikis between Yavan and Yisrael, Yavan believes in Hadar. Hadar is outer external beauty and the outer external mechanism of the universe. But Yisrael believes in Hoid. Hoid is Ziv Penimi. You can't measure it, you can't calculate it, you can't weigh it. But we know it's there. And we also know that we don't believe in Teva. There's no Teva. There's no, oh, it automatically rains. Or if you go to the gym, you'll automatically be healthy. There are principles with which Hashem guides the world. There ain't by teva klal. Behind the scenes, your health, your wealth are dependent on Torah and Mitzvot, and you can't measure it, you can't see it, you can't weigh it. That's Hoid. The difference between Hoid and Hadar, Hadar is the outer facade of beauty and the running of the world. Hoid is the inner mechanism of the intangible quality that a person could have, and the Hashgacha Pratit with which HaKadosh Baruch Hu runs the world. So what's the purpose of Hanukkah? To demonstrate that Hadar is not all there is in this world. It's not all about external beauty. Chanukah is to help us appreciate Ein Boi Teva. There is no chiluk between Shemen and Chometz. This is not an answer that somebody came up with. You know why we have an extra day of Chanukah? Because oil burning is also a miracle. No, the whole essence of Chanukah is Midas Hoid. Hoid is to see the inner splendor of the universe. There's no Teva. Teva is a facade. It's a cloak. It's a shell. It's a veil. If you pull away the veil, Shemen burning is just as great of a miracle. One last point. Vilna Gaon writes in Sefer Imrei Noam, Midah of Hoida, of gratitude, the root of gratitude is Hoid. This is a very important idea. You know why we have such a hard time having Hakarat HaTov? Why should I have Hakarat HaTov to God? Because I have money? Yeah, I have money. You know I have money? Because I went to college and I studied for 4 years. And then I went to graduate school. And then I, for 10 years, I woke up 4 o'clock in the morning. I stayed in the office for 14 hours. So of course I have money. God, I have money without you. What do I need to thank you for? I have money because that's the way the world works. Teva! I went to school. I worked hard. So I have money. Hadar! When you only believe in Teva, why do you need to have gratitude to God? But when you recognize, you know how many people that went to school and got a graduate degree and stayed in the office 14 hours and they're aniyim ve'evyonim. So it's not because of your hard work. It's because the Lord in His infinite mercy on you gave you parnassah. No thanks to anything you did. If you would have come home 3 hours early and learned a few black gemara, maybe you would have had more money. So the reason we don't have gratitude is because we believe in hadar and teva. Why do I have to thank God for I have children? So what? No kidding, I have children. Because I got married. That's what happened. You get married, and then a few years later, you have a couple of kids. Because we take it for granted. We believe in hadar. We believe in teva. You get married, you have children. But Yisrael doesn't believe in hadar. We believe in hoyd. That people could try to have children, but it doesn't necessarily go until the Almighty blesses you, Barachavei Shamayim, with a family, and each child is a miracle, Shein Kamayu. That's Nisim. There's no Teva. That's Hoyd. If you believe in Hoyd, you have Hoydah. If you believe in Hadar, it's all coming to you. Whatever you have is just natural. So the essence of the Yom Tov of Chanukah is the Midah of Hoyd. Not to get caught up with the way things look externally, to realize that there's an inner mechanism of the universe, and that is Hashem guides this world based on our ma'asim tovim, b'chesed u'b'rachamei shamayim, and if we believe in midat ha'hod, we will have hoydah, and therefore Chanukah is 8 days. It's not just a nice answer. You know what the 8th day of Chanukah is for? That oil burns. It's inherent. It's fundamental to the message of Chanukah. So I thank everybody for listening. Again, the Limud Torah should be Lila Nishmas Mani Ben Rivka, Chananel Ben Esther. Thank Rabrani for the opportunity. Yaakov Ben Shlomo. Bershut Rabbi Saban. Amivarech. All of you should continue to learn from the Rav Shlita. The Rav should have many happy and healthy years for him and his family. Amen. To lead and to elevate the kihilah. Ad bias kol tzedek. And bezus Hashem, Chanukah Sameach, Shabbat Shalom. Thank you very much. Hey.
You've just experienced another Torah class brought to you by TorahAnytime.com.